responds to this wondrous news that she has been given. And let's hear it now. It's perfect. Thank you.
Yes, it is in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 46 to 56. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." Mary stayed with Elizabeth for about 3 months and then returned home. May God bless the reading of his word.
Thank you, Lily. Well, we talk a lot this time of the year about being on a journey to Christmas, about getting our hearts ready for Christmas. And we think about that. How do we do that? What's some practical ways that we can get ready for Christmas? Well, I'll tell you, there's no better person that we can look at or think about or study than Mary. Mary has a unique place in the gospel. I mean, for this reason alone, it's important that we should look to her and want to study her, because she was there from the time Jesus was conceived throughout his ministry. She appears at different times during his ministry, of course, with him growing up as well. She was there at the cross when he was crucified. She was there during the day of his resurrection, and she was even there on Pentecost. Pentecost Sunday, Mary was there when the church was born and when God's Spirit and Christ's Spirit came into the church. She knew the whole story. I don't think anybody knew Jesus better than his mother, than Mary did. And all of that is, that's worth thinking about her, and especially, too, during this time of the year, as we're thinking about preparing for Christmas, because Mary was the first person to do that. She was the first person to prepare her heart and mind for Christmas. And I'll tell you, there is nobody that we see in Scripture that has a purer, more beautiful relationship to God and a more immediate desire to do God's will in her life. How she just wants to do exactly what God wants from her. And so the great thing is, this time of the year, it's great that we can read about Mary, because it's a part of our Advent reading, is to read and study about her and read this first chapter of Luke, which is the best place. As I said, Mary's there all throughout the Gospels and all the way into the book of Acts. All of that, she's there. But this verse, this chapter is really about her. And we learn a lot about her. We learn that she's engaged to a fellow named Joseph. We learned that she lives in Nazareth. We learned that she's probably of the line and the descendant of David, just like her fiancé Joseph was. We're not for sure about that, but it's from the reading, it sounds likely she's a part of that family, the family of David. And then we learned some other amazing things about her. During this episode where the angel comes and visits her, that she's going to conceive of the Holy Spirit, she's going to have this child that's going to be God's son. And hearing all of this, one thing we can see and a way we can sort of get our hearts ready for Christmas is to think about the way Mary responded to the news of the first Christmas. And the way that she responded, what she said when the angel told her all of these amazing things, is she said, "I'm the Lord's servant. I'm ready. May what you have said come to pass." I mean, she is ready to do exactly what God wants for her right away. It doesn't take any convincing. It doesn't take any talking to. She is ready to do God's will. How unusual that is, especially as you look at the Bible and as you read the stories of people being called to different ministries. really, I mean, almost all the time. First of all, they're afraid, and they're scared when they see an angel, which Mary doesn't seem to have been scared at all. She was ready. She was ready to see this angel and to understand who he was and why he was there. He was God's messenger. She was ready for that, absolutely. And she was ready to hear this message that he had for her. She was just always ready to do God's will. Yeah, you look at Moses, and Moses got called at the burning bush. So a very similar experience to Mary. Mary had an angel come just at the burning bush, Moses had the burning bush. He was talking right to God, and God was telling him. God was saying, you need to go and get your people free from Egypt. And Moses first said, what if they don't believe me? And God had a response to that. He said, well, what if they ask me who sent them? And God had a response to that. He said, but God, I'm not very good at talking. What should I do about that? And God told him what he should do about that. And then after all of these times, if he has some reason he doesn't want to do this, finally he says, God, choose someone else. Pick someone else, please. How often I hear this when it comes to people grappling and struggling with some calling to some sort of ministry that they have. They feel like God wants them to do something, but you know, they don't really understand it fully. Maybe they don't understand the call fully, or they don't like what they're hearing. One thing about going to seminary and studying to be a minister is you hear all your friends talk about how they came to decide to become ministers and feel called to ministry. And believe me, there's not one of them who feels that call to ministry, who feels God saying, become a minister, and says, okay, that sounds great. I'll do that. I'll get in seminary right away, and I'm going to change all these things about my life. I'm going to become a minister. No, there's always a struggle. There's always, and people go through one thing after another, and then finally, to be able to say yes. This is what God wants for me. I mean, I feel like my calling to ministry occurred over the course of 20 years. Ups and downs in that calling until finally I could understand what God wanted, and I was willing to respond to what God wanted for me in my life. Here is Mary, this practically a child. This young lady, already she is ready to do God's will and to do it immediately. Boy, why is that? What did she do? What's her secret? Here she is, this young person, ready and willing to do what God would have her do. What was her secret? Well, the angel gives us a clue about that. The angel says, Mary, the Lord is with you. Or in another translation, Mary, you are full of grace. Now this tells me that Mary had opened her heart to God. She had opened her heart. She had let God's love fill her heart up. And I'll tell you, there is no better way to be willing to do God's will than to have a heart full of God's love. How can we ever imagine? How can we ever hope to do God's will if we don't have a heart full of God's love? That's a step for us today. Be able to open our hearts. Let God fill up our hearts with joy. This is the time of the year to do it. This message of Christmas, if we'll just remember it, think about it. Read it like we're reading it for the first time and say, God has given us his son. Why? Because he loves us. He loves us. That should fill our hearts with joy. That should fill our hearts with love. And I'll tell you, when you have a full heart like that, you're going to be ready to do God's will. You're going to be ready to celebrate Christmas the way it should be celebrated. You're going to be ready to experience the next 3 weeks the way God intends you to spend the next 3 weeks. Mary was ready to hear this word from God and to respond to it because her heart was full of God's love. That's a challenge for us today. Every day to wake up and let God fill our hearts up with his love. How happy we would be. How joyful. But let me tell you, more than just being happy and joyful, it's going to spill over into the lives of others. Because that's exactly what happened with Mary. Her joy spilled over into the lives of other people. She was sent away. I don't know if it was because she was pregnant, but maybe they found out she was pregnant. Sure sounds like it. Sounds like they found out she was pregnant. They sent her away to her cousin, Elizabeth. And Elizabeth was having her own miraculous pregnancy. She had never had a child before. She was over the age that most women would bear children, but she was here having her first son. And she was, as they say in the Bible, great with child. And she was there, and John the Baptist, she was going to have John the Baptist, Jesus' cousin. And when Mary entered the room, the scriptures say that John, in her womb, jumped with joy or with excitement. And right away, Elizabeth knew something special was going on with Mary. And she said to Mary, Mary, blessed are you among all women. And blessed is the fruit of your womb. Blessed is the child that you bear. And then Mary, at this point, that's when Mary responds with this beautiful scripture reading that Ellie read for us so beautifully a moment ago. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. My soul magnifies the Lord. See, Mary wasn't content with just being joyful about her faith, just being happy about this wondrous event that was happening, to be happy to have her heart full of God's love. That wasn't enough. See, she wanted to magnify it. She wanted it to spill over. So here's what we need to do in our lives. We feel that love in our lives. We feel it in our hearts. Oh, we're so happy. We're so joyful. But we need to make sure our hearts are a fruitful place, that it's a place where our soul can then magnify God's presence. And we can then be a blessing to others. And I know that sounds unusual. I mean, you think of magnifying light usually. That's what I think of magnifying. How do we magnify God? How do we magnify God's Spirit? Well, let me tell you this, and maybe this will help, because it helped me when I started thinking about all the things I magnify in my life. And I'm an expert at it. I'm an expert at magnifying the things in my life, that they're all just in the right place, and I have just the right things that I need. I am great at magnifying the importance of possessions. I'm wonderful at magnifying the importance of wealth. Having enough money, yes, to provide everything, and then as much more as I can possibly get. Yes, I'm great at magnifying the importance of that. I'm great at magnifying the importance of celebrities. It's crazy. I'm not that big of a movie fan or go to a lot of movies, but boy, I know what's going on in the lives of all these celebrities because I have magnified their importance in my life. They have become very, very important to me. And I'll tell you, I have magnified beyond all reason the importance of the 50, 60, 100 people that are best at throwing a ball. They're best in the world at throwing a ball, and I have magnified their importance greatly. Now, we can magnify, and we do all sorts of things. And here is Mary telling us, you know, think about magnifying God. That's what I'm doing. Yes, I feel God's love in my heart. God is with me. God's grace is with me. I feel God's love, yes, but I am magnifying it as well. Not these other silly things in life. Magnify what's really important. That's not that those things are bad, right? Just don't make them more important than they should be. And that's a great lesson for us here during this Christmas season because, boy, we could make the most important thing about Christmas, the presents, the food, the parties, the decorations. We could make those most important. We could magnify them beyond all reason. Or we can magnify what is most important. But I was telling the children today, God loves us so much that he sent us his son. That is the magnitude of his love. That's how much love we should be feeling in our hearts. And how can we magnify that in this world? Well, it's all our attitude. It's our actions. It's the words that we speak. You know, when Mary was magnifying the Lord, when she read this or didn't read it, she spoke these beautiful words that Ellie read a moment ago. She was magnifying the love of God by saying these words that we're still saying today. And we can do the same thing. Don't just be, the story of the Scrooge. I think y'all know this story. I probably don't even describe it to you, but you know, the ghosts come, Scrooge is a mean guy, and then he wakes up on Christmas morning and he hears the bells, right? And does he just go, I'm so happy, man, my heart's full of love now, and roll over and go back to sleep? No, that's not the story. His soul magnifies that love. He wakes up and he's buying Christmas dinners and buying Tiny Tim's medical treatments and giving to charity, doing all these wonderful things to show that this love is in his heart. That love is magnified within him. That's the way we need to live our lives. That's how we can prepare for this Christmas. So that's my prayer for you today. That's my prayer for myself today, is that we can be thinking in this way as Christmas comes. We can work every day on filling our heart with God's love. Feeling that every day and feeling the joy and the gratitude that comes from this idea that God loved us and loves us this much to send his son. And might we pray too for myself and for all of you that this is a fertile ground in our hearts here. And that love grows and it starts spilling out to others. It starts spilling out in our workplaces and in our churches and in our neighborhoods, among our community. And this community just becomes a more and more joyful place because of the love that you show and the love that's magnified in your life. I'll tell you, if we can do these things, then we're going to be able to look at the decorations and eat the food and go to the parties, and it's all going to make sense to us. Because each one of these things is going to remind us of God's great love for each and every one of us. Let's bow. Loving God, we do ask that, like Mary, we let our hearts be filled with your love this holiday season. And loving God, like her, help our hearts to be a fertile place where that love can be magnified. And God, help us to feel that each day as we approach Christmas so that we can wake up Christmas morning full of joy and ready to share with all of those we love. Dear Lord, we prepare right now together around this table a way that we can get ready for this Christmas that is to come, a way that we can get our hearts set for these days that we have ahead. Loving God, help us to feel your spirit as we gather around this table. Help us to be nourished and uplifted by these elements that we receive here. And loving God, help us as we gather around this table as one community, help us to feel the love of that family. Lord, all these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.